Amen. So I did want to comment. I am wearing a suit today. I got up and I could hear my mom's voice and her New York accent.
Sean, could you please just wear a suit today? It is Easter after all.
So this is for my mother and for Jesus. I lost my mom in June. This is my first Easter without her. But it was kind of a little chuckle I had with her this morning putting this on. So, in the Bible, we're going to spend most of the time in the Gospel of Luke and his account of what took place today. But I wanted to start, you know, we talked about Thursday and what took place. To understand Sunday, we have to understand a little bit of Friday. You know, over 30 people were killed in Brussels. 120 plus were killed in Spain. Yesterday, 5 U.S. soldiers died in a helicopter crash. Last week, 2 U.S. Marines were killed in a bomb in Iraq. Last night, 2 people were shot on the east side of San Antonio. 6 months ago, there was a man murdered here in Schertz. Scores of Christians have been slaughtered in Nigeria, Syria, Iraq. We're $20 trillion in debt, folks. The divorce rate is off the chart. They can't even keep up with it. You don't have to go far to find these senseless acts are all under the umbrella of one thing, and it's called sin. Sin. What is sin? Sin is the unbelief of what God has said. And in Romans chapter 3, we have a small account of an enormous truth that we have to understand before we get to Sunday. You see, men, they either reject the notion of God, therefore placing themselves as God, as if everything was created by chance, because they sure know they didn't create this. Obviously, the creation was not made by some man. So, it's got to be by chance then. Then if you do acknowledge that there is a higher being, an intelligent being that's higher than us, well, then that means that we have to place ourselves under his authority and possibly be accountable to him. So what do? We make up this notion that hopefully I'm more good than I am bad. And at the end of this whole deal, he's going to weigh out the balance and see that I've paid enough of my taxes and I helped enough little old ladies to wipe out the sin in my life. Well, the Bible completely rejects that. And let's examine it right now. In Romans chapter 3, verse 20. For by the works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight. What does that mean? Your good behavior is not going to justify you. Forget it. Throw it away, for it is an idol, and it will condemn you to hell. No works of the law will you be justified, no human being. Because since through the law comes the knowledge of sin. Through the law comes the knowledge of sin. What is conscience? What is your conscience? The word conscience comes from C-O-N, which means with. The prefix is with. Science, knowledge. With knowledge that what we do is wrong. God put it in all of us. You know it's wrong to lie. You know it's wrong to steal. It's there. Now, Romans also says that we sear that conscience. So some of us, we're more convicted than others. It's amazing what you can see. I mean, the very act of blowing yourself up to kill innocent people, and then the thought that you're doing it in the name of God with no conscience violation. Quite a searing of the heart. Well, let's go farther. Verse 21. But now the righteousness of God has been made manifest apart from the law, apart from your good works. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, verse 22, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Do you hear that? The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. It don't matter who you are, what color you are, how you were raised, what money is in your bank account. It does not matter. There is no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And, I love that. There's no period. It doesn't stop there. And are justified. That's a legal term. In court of law, you're justified. And are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. What does that mean? I heard a quote, and it's so true. You see, our sins are not forgiven because of what the Romans did to Jesus. No, our sins are forgiven because of what God did to Jesus. What God did to Jesus. Isaiah chapter 53 said, it pleased Yahweh. It pleased God to crush him. What? Why would it please God to crush his own son? Because God is a God of justice. He is a judge. Just like it would be ludicrous to see a murderer and rapist go stand before a judge in the court of law and say, Judge, I am sorry for what I've done. And the judge say, okay, I believe you. He's innocent. You're justified. Walk out of the courtroom. That's no justice. That's ridiculous. You'd question whether or not that judge was bribed. Because obviously he knows nothing of upholding the law and justice. You see, our God cannot be bribed. There's no negotiation, for all have sinned, and the wages of sin is death. There's no compromise. There's no, but God, I promise I'll never do. No. Ask yourself, have you ever told a lie? That makes you a liar. Makes me a liar. Have you ever stolen anything, regardless of its value? That makes you a thief. Makes me a thief. Have you ever blasphemed his name and said, oh, gosh, dang it. But the other one, to take God, the one in whom gave us life and breathes life into you, take his name and use it as a cuss word to express disgust. The Bible says, I will not hold him guiltless who uses my name in vain. So, therefore, God put him forward as a propitiation. That's a big $10 word, and this is what it means. That the wrath of God was satisfied fully in his son. That he who knew no sin became sin, so that we could become the righteousness of God. Imagine that. Think of your own sin. Examine your own heart. Examine it. Think how heinous it is. And then take it and put it on the spotless Lamb of God, the one in whom there was no sin, the one in whom said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, who all things were created by him, through him, and for him. All things exist and return to him, and by his power the universe is sustained. Take your sin and put it upon him. The wrath of God was poured out. It was poured out upon Jesus. In the Garden of Gethsemane, some of you have read, he's on his knees, he's praying, he's hard-pressed in the Greek. He's so hard-pressed, he's sweating blood. Do you think he was fearing the Romans? Obviously not, as you read the scripture. They come to arrest him. Peter, whack, cuts off the ear of one of the guards, tries to save, you know. Jesus, very calmly, heals the guy's ear. Says, Peter, those who live by the sword will die by the sword. Don't you realize I could call down legions of angels right now and wipe them all out? You think he was scared as they walked up and said, where is Jesus? And he said, I am he. And bam, they all fell on their back. No. Why was he perplexed? Because he knew the sin that was about to be laid upon him and the wrath that was coming from the Father. Jesus, the Father, the Holy Spirit, the triune God, the one triune, majestic, mysterious, amazing, omnipotent, omniscient God has existed for all of eternity in community and relationship. On that cross, the Word who became flesh, he's placarded, he's nailed at 9 o'clock in the morning. About 12 o'clock in the afternoon, it said darkness came over the land. The sin was being atoned for. And about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, he cried out. Not far off inside the city, what was going on is that the high priest was sacrificing the lamb. A lamb. And at the exact same time, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus cries out, Eli, Eli, Sama Bakhtani, my God, why have you forsaken me? The Father condemned his own son for justice, for the justice. And that's what we read here. For he put him forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness. It had to happen, folks. He couldn't have just looked at you and me and said, oh, well, I love them so much, they're forgiven. There's no justice in that. There had to be the shedding of blood, Romans 9:22. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. You're not forgiven because you pray at night, God, forgive me for my sins. You're not forgiven for that. You're not even forgiven for being sorry. You are forgiven because his son, the lamb, was slaughtered. And your faith is in that. Alone. Not in a prayer, not in a church membership, not for being sorry. People say, well, that's what repentance is. No, repentance is turning away from and turning towards God. Not just before you go to sleep, as you're falling, God, please forgive me for my sin. No, the forgiveness is in the blood of Jesus Christ alone. And that's what we read here. For it was to show God's righteousness before in his divine forbearance, he passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. There's the key that I want you to get right here. He was both just and justifier. So he was just in saying that we're forgiven. Why? Because Christ was slaughtered on the cross. There's the just, the sin was paid for. And he's both justifier. So now when Satan says, hey, look over there at Sean and his sin. How can you forgive him? How can you let him into heaven? And all God has to do, the Father, is say, this is why. Silence and defeat the enemy. Satan has no accusation anymore for anyone who places their faith in Jesus Christ. Y'all need to hold on to that. It's very, very, very important. So therefore, John 5:24 says, if you put your faith in him, you have eternal life. You've passed from death to life. You've passed from death to life. It's amazing. Now, let's pick up Luke 24, verse 1. Luke 24, we have an account, although 2,000 years ago, this took place on this day. What's awesome is God has preserved his word so that we can see exactly what took place as if we were there. Now, chapter 24 of Luke's gospel, verse 1. Follow along. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men standing by them, dazzling apparel, were as if they were frightened, bowed their faces to the ground. The men said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here. He's risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise. And they remembered his words. Returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now, it was Mary Magdalene and Jonah and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them as an idle tale. And they did not believe them. But Peter rose. He ran to the tomb, stooping in and looking. He saw the linen cloths by themselves. He went home marveling at what had happened. Verse 13, and that very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, what is this conversation that you're holding with each other as you walk along? They stood there looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, are you the only one in Jerusalem that hasn't heard about all the things that happened? And he said to them, what things? And they said to him, concerning Jesus the Nazarene, a man who was a prophet. He was mighty in deed and word before God and all people. Now the chief priests and the rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucify him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yeah, and besides all this, it's now the third day since all these things have happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They went to the tomb this morning. They did not find his body, and they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found just as what the women said. But him, they didn't see him. As he said to this, Jesus said to them, oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all the prophets had spoken. It was necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory. And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted these things to them. He interpreted all the scriptures concerning himself. So they drew near the village to which they were going. He acted as if they were going further, but they urged him strongly to stay with us. For it was toward evening that day, and they were far spent. So he went to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, he blessed it, and he broke it. And he gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while we were talking with him on the road? While he opened to us the scriptures. Now, I read quite a bit. One of the reasons I did is because I want you to hear the word of God and not so much of me. So much, we only take a snippet here of scripture, there and there and here. We need to have the full breadth of what it says and what took place. So, it's the morning, the third day. Women go to the tomb who love Jesus. They were bringing spices, extra spices there. Why? Because they're expecting to encounter the smell of rotting flesh. You see, it was the Sabbath when he was crucified. So they didn't have time to prepare his body. So they had to wait because of the law until the Sabbath was over. And then they went the morning to prepare the spices to do away with the smell. And they encounter this, the tomb is empty. And it said they're perplexed. They're confused. Why? He told them he would rise. He told them. But they're perplexed. They're expecting to find the body, but it's not there. Then two angels even appear and say, why are you looking for the living among the dead? And they still don't understand They know they don't see his body. They're afraid because they see these angels. Obviously, the appearance of the brightness of these angels was more than what they could take. They fell down on their face in terror. Then they got up. They marveled. And they ran back to the disciples. And what does the Bible say? The very disciples in whom Jesus handpicked, walked with, taught them, did miracles with, rose Lazarus, they said, this sounds like a tale. This sounds like something y'all just made. What are you talking about? He's not there. Of course he's there. I saw him die with my own eyes. Of course he's there. So much of what we do and what we believe is based on what we can see. And that is a huge problem. Like Thomas, I'm not going to believe no matter what. I'm going to have to stick my finger in the hole on his side and touch the holes in his hands before I believe. And Jesus said, blessed is he, Thomas, who believes who have not seen. I ask you, do you believe this? That 2,000 years ago, the Lord Jesus Christ rose physically from the dead. Well, they had a hard time with it. They didn't understand it. Peter took off running towards that tomb. He looks in there. He sees the linen. He doesn't see Jesus, though. And it says he went home marveled at what just took place. Imagine what's going on in these guys' eyes. Now, we can tell by their disbelief, they are walking around hopeless. Hopeless. It said they were sad. Their faces were sad. Why? Because they're still living like it's Friday. They're still living like it's Saturday. And oh, do we do the same thing? Do I do the same thing? I act like it's hopeless. He's on the cross. He died. Not looking and believing and trusting in that Friday doesn't matter without Sunday. Without the resurrection of our Lord, it all is nothing. And in fact, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15 that without the resurrection, our faith is futile and we're still in our sins. Hopelessness. You know, I walked around Walmart last night. I had to go get some coffee. And as I'm walking around, people are going to and fro. This was almost 10 o'clock at night, and the place was packed full of people. And as you look upon their eyes, you can see hopelessness, pain. Just wondering what's going on through this couple's mind. As they're putting stuff in their basket, and they have three children. It's 10 o'clock. Wondering if they're going to be able to even pay at the register. Who's been there? I've been there. You know, the pain, the hopelessness. What's next? Thinking, well, if I get this job, then. If I do this, then. See, everybody's looking for a savior, folks. The two men walking to Emmaus, what'd they say? We had hoped that he would be the one to redeem us from Israel. But it's been 3 days. It's been 3 days. Now, they're talking to some wise tale that he's rose from the dead, but I know that it didn't happen. I saw they put those Roman guards in front of that tomb with my own eyes. I saw him die. They're hopeless. They're hopeless. You see, we cannot look for a savior in anything other than Jesus Christ, because all of it will turn to gravel in your mouth. How do I know? How do I know everyone's looking for a savior? How do I know? The word savior means to be saved from. Saved from what? Pain. Life is pain. How do I know? Go out Friday night. Every bar is full. Go to the strip clubs. It's full of people. Having fun. Oh, this is a lot of fun. But they're hopeless underneath. I've been there. I've walked through the bar in the bathroom, just walked out, having a great time, woo! And I go look in the mirror when no one's in the bathroom, look in them drunk eyes, and I see hopelessness. Hopelessness. These disciples, they were not believing what Jesus had said. In 3 days, I will rise. I will rebuild this temple. But yet they didn't believe. Even though the scriptures in which they've studied their whole lives proclaim it. How many of us have heard the Bible stories our whole life? But yet, we still are walking as if he has not risen. As if there isn't someone who's going to stamp out ISIS himself. It's not going to be the United States government. It's going to be Jesus Christ. A sword will come from his mouth, it says. He will stamp out his enemies. He will dash them to pieces. He came through Jerusalem on Sunday on a donkey. But the next time, Revelation 19 says he's coming on a white stallion to conquer as a king, to take back everything that's his. Everything that's his. You see, we look for a slogan, right? To save our country. No, it's, you know, I understand Make America Great Again. I understand all the other campaigns and their deal and everything like that. Let me tell you a slogan. Let me tell you what's going to save. It's called 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will seek my face, humble themselves, and turn from their sins, I will hear their prayers from heaven, and I'll heal their land. Look for a Savior. There's only one. There's only one. And it's not the grass greener on the other side. There's no hope in another marriage or another relationship. There's no hope in another job or another car or another baby or another house. Why? You know, if you've hoped in those next, or Friday, right? It's Monday. Oh, I can't wait till Friday. Woo! Friday comes, Saturday morning, your head's in a vice, and you're like, oh, what? I don't even remember it. It was so wonderful, but I don't remember. There's no hope. It's empty. It's empty. The only lasting hope is in Jesus Christ. That's it. That's it. And what's amazing is our God is alive and personal in a relationship. I remember when I first came to Christ. Things were wonderful. I was on this mountaintop. And then all of a sudden, life started happening again. And I remember I prayed to the Lord. Lord, you said I'd never be hungry. I'm hungry. You said I'd never be thirsty, but now I'm thirsty. What's going on? And the Lord said, I've shown you. I've shown you where to be fed. I've shown you where to drink. But you want to take a pill. You want to turn on a TV show and in 30 minutes be healed. You want to undo 23 years. You want to undo 23 years of living for yourself. And he could. He could undo all of it. He could. But you know what? He desires a relationship. He desires for you to walk with him in life, in the high times and the low times, the good times and the bad times. And he says this, and he's saying it to all of you right now. In this world, there is trouble. Period. Okay? In this world, there is trouble. You're not going to hear from anyone standing up here that it's wonderful and your best life now and all of this nonsense that these prosperity preachers are preaching. Nonsense. No, what you're going to hear is it's hard. It's rough. Marriage is hard. You got to work at it. You got to do your fighting on your knees together, realizing that you have an enemy who right at that point was attacking these disciples, making them hopeless, believing he was dead or that they had taken his body and they'd done something with it. But we keep going. Jesus shows up, starts walking along these disciples on the road to Emmaus. They were so stuck on Jesus coming and liberating them from the nation of Israel. They forgot that he would be hope, his name would be a blessing to the nations, that their sins would be forgiven and blotted out. Like Daniel 9 says, he will do away with transgression. Your sins will be as far away from the east as from the west. They knew the blood of goats wouldn't do that. But it wasn't until Jesus came alongside them, and opened their eyes to the scripture. Look with me. So, verse 28. They drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going further, but they urged him strongly to stay. They urged him strongly to stay. Why? Because he's saying something. They still didn't know who this guy was. They didn't recognize him. But he's saying some stuff that's gathering their interest, you know? And so they urged him to stay. Then what? Staying with them, for it was towards the evening. So he went and he stayed with them. And when he was at the table, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, gave to them, and their eyes were opened. What does this show us, and what does this teach us? That though we may have unbelief, at times we may have a lack of faith, at times we may be hopeless, when you draw near to the Lord, he draws near to you. And these disciples sat with him at the table. They urged him to stay, and he opened up their eyes. Some of the sweetest times I've had with the Lord is when I've been the most busiest. But I make myself, although everything in the flesh says you have a million things to do, I make myself grab the scripture and go be alone with the Lord. I close the door behind me, and I don't come out. And sometimes I've gone in there frustrated, feeling like God is a million miles away. And as I seek him and I open up the word and I pray, oh God, I don't even know what else to say, just oh God, that's when he shows up and illuminates my eyes to the truth that he is resurrected, that I do have a hope, and that he is the source of faith. And if I pray, God, increase my faith. At times it's hard, I don't believe. I admit to myself, you see, yourself will deceive you. Well, of course you believe, you preach. Of course, you got it all together. You're wearing a suit. I allow myself to say, oh God, I need you. I need you now. But you got to humble yourself. You got to get alone with God yourself. You know what the Bible says? You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with your whole heart. See, God wants all of you. He doesn't want just a piece of you. He wants all of you. Because he knows. He knows every hair on your head. He knows the deepest, most intricate part of your soul. The pain that you don't even know. The pain that you've stuffed away and you won't access. It's in that filing cabinet and you don't go near it. He knows it. He's felt it. In fact, Hebrews says that he has experienced it with you. But you got to walk with him just like they did. They walked with him along the road. This is not a Sunday morning thing, folks. This is not a Christmas and Easter. Why? Why? Why are our churches bigger? We have more people on Christmas and Easter. Why? Why? Because everyone's looking for a Savior. They're looking for a Savior. The question is, do you want it to be Jesus? Do you want it to be Jesus? Listen to some of these things people have made up. Heaven, 72 virgins. Drunken parties in heaven. You know, see, people want to go to heaven. They just don't want God to be there. Right? They want their own desires. They want their own ideas. But see, he's revealed himself, folks, and he'll reveal himself to you just like he did to them. But you got to get at the table. You got to be near him. You got to be close to him. It is not about walking with other people in church. Although that is God's design for the church, there's no lone ranger Christian. In the Bible, you never, ever see that. They gather together. Do not neglect the meeting with one another, but gather together as you see the day approaching for encouragement, for prayer. How else are you going to have anyone pray for you? How else are you going to be encouraged if you don't walk with other Christians? Now, verse 25. Jesus rebukes them for their lack of faith and their unbelief. It's okay to be rebuked by the Lord. In fact, Hebrews 12 says, don't despise the discipline of the Lord. Why? Because a loving father disciplines their child. A loving father disciplines their child. It says, if you're not disciplined, then you're illegitimate. You're not his. If you can just walk around and wallow in sin, do whatever you want, go to and fro, then is he your father? You see, a lot of people believe that everyone is God's child. That's not what the Bible teaches. In fact, He says, to all who believed in his name and received him, he gave the right to become children of God. Don't despise his rebuke. Don't despise his discipline, for he loves his children, and every loving father disciplines their child. I heard this example. I think it's a good one. And matter of fact, it's going to be quite relevant for me since I'm having a daughter. Thank you. Thank you. But let me ask you, if at 2 o'clock in the morning, say I was coming home from work, I drive around the corner on the street and I see my daughter, 14 years old, out there on the block with a bunch of guys. And her brother better be over there whooping some butt, but anyway. Bunch of guys and sitting there on the block just having fun, right? Smoking, doing the 14-year-old thing. And I drive by and I see her and I just wave, hey, babe. Drive, pull in the driveway and go into bed. Now, what kind of father would I be? What kind of dad would I be? No, it's going to be, I'm going to get that young lady and we're going home. Some of you need to let God take you home. You need to let God bring you out of where you're out hanging out or what you're looking at when no one's else looking on the computer. You need to let God bring you home and be near his side, be at his table, and so that your eyes would be open to the truth and that your unbelief would be transformed into belief. You see, what makes us go out and pursue those things? It's the unbelief that God is all sufficient. It's the unbelief that God provides, right? We got to get hope in a substance, whether it's marijuana or some type of drug, alcohol, or it's sex, or it's this or it's that. That's where we get our little fulfillment, our little shot, you know, our little boom, I feel better. But then you're empty, even more empty. It's unbelief that what God says, come to me all who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Come to me. Come to me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me, for I will give you eternal life. I am the resurrection and life. I am the gate. I am the good shepherd. My sheep hear my voice and they follow me. If you call yourself his, if you call yourself a sheep of Jesus Christ, then follow him. John 6, he said to the crowd, why do you call me Lord and not do what I say? He has resurrected, folks. Let's live as if we know that. Let's live as if we believe that. Because if you do, it changes the way you live your daily life. Okay, look at the disciples. They started out in the morning, sad-faced, perplexed, not believing the tale. Now, this is some kind of idle fairy tale. But as the day went on, Jesus showed up to them. In verse 28 through 30, so they drew near to the village, right? It was evening, broke the bread, their eyes were opened. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us as he talked to us on the road as he opened the scriptures? You see, now they were distracted from their pain. The pain was gone. It's like childbirth. It's like agonizing. The baby's coming. The baby comes out. And it's a God-given amnesia through the endorphins that are released into the body. The pain is gone. The baby's here. You see? They were distracted. They were distracted by truth. They were believing a lie. Truth, bam, knocked that out of the park. We need that Monday morning, folks. We need that at 3 o'clock in the afternoon on Wednesday. We need that when you get the phone call, so-and-so has died, or so-and-so has cancer. You've got to have it. What else do you have? What else do you have? You're just going to live for the next thing, right? I mean, look at Apple. You know, bigger, smaller, bigger. We got to, you know, give me a break. I've done that, by the way. Now, a few last things and then we will close. Let's look, verse 36. As they were talking among these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you." Who in here would not desire and experience peace? Do we experience every moment of every day of our life? Absolutely not. But that's what the hope of glory is for. The hope of his Sabbath rest that is coming. It is coming. There will be a time in which we'll experience peace forever. But you can experience peace when you draw near to God. When you draw near to Christ. And when he shows up in your room, when the door's closed. Remember Jesus? He said, don't go out and pray among all the people so you can be seen. No, I tell you, go into your room. Shut the door where no one's watching, and your Father, who sees you in secret, will bless you. You see, he shows up here. Peace be with you. In fact, in John, it tells us the door was locked. They were afraid. They were afraid that what happened to Jesus was going to happen to them. Jesus, boom, right through the door. He can lock right through the locked door of your heart. The place in which your heart that nobody has access to, including yourself, you won't allow yourself to go there. He can go right through it and say, "Peace. Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened as if they saw a ghost. They still weren't believing. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled?" Let Jesus say that to you today. Let him say it to me. Why are you troubled? I'm alive. I'm ruling. I'm reigning. I'm the King of Kings. I'm the Lord of Lords, and I'm coming back. And he said, "Why are you troubled? Why doubt arise in your heart? See my hands and feet? Touch me. See. For a spirit doesn't have flesh and bones as I have." He says, "Have you had anything to eat?" He's hungry. Again, he wants to share a meal. Why do you think God invented food? I mean, he could have created us in a way that we didn't have to eat any food. But why did he? Why did he create thirst? It's not strange that he calls himself the bread of life. It's not strange that he says you don't live on bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God. It's not strange that he says, "I am living water." That desire in your belly when you get hungry, when you haven't eaten breakfast, the desire you might have right now, and I just keep talking, that's given to you by God to desire him. Why does he give us a wife or a husband as a picture? Why does he give us children as a picture? All of creation is to reveal his glory. You got to see that. The very trees stick their limbs out in praise and glory. The flowers rise from the ground for his glory. It's all for his glory. Don't be distracted. Now, do you have anything to eat? He wants to share a meal. Then they said, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything was written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. You may open the Bible and say, "I don't get it. I don't understand it." You ask God for it, and he will. Thus it is written that the Christ, the Messiah, would suffer, and on the third day, he'd rise from the dead. Again, he reminds them of what he has said upon what he has said. Sometimes we need reminders of what he has said. When we do fall into sin, you need a reminder of what he has said. And that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations. The forgiveness through that cross and the acceptance of that propitiation and the resurrection. You must hold on to that, folks. I cannot do anything. We can't stay here long enough for me to make it permeate your heart. I cannot do it. There's nothing more pathetic than me or anyone else standing up here trying to teach you. Trust me, it's hard. I can't get it into your heart, but God can. God can. Seek him. Draw near to him. Stop making excuses and be his child. Walk in faith, although it may be the size of a mustard seed. He can grow it and to be the largest tree. And so that you would take this gospel and the repentance and forgiveness of sins through him, you will then begin to proclaim it to all the nations. Walk in truth today. Don't hold your head down. It is Sunday. Today is a day of celebration. Walk in his hope today. Let him say to you, peace be with you. I told you. I've rose from the dead. Let's pray.